All right. Good evening and welcome back to the Dunnigan Music and Movie Podcast. I'm Devin Dunnigan, and here with once again is Mr. Stephen Mott. How you doing, Steve?
Great, brother.
That's awesome. Well, we are back today with our second episode to review the 1976 classic by Kiss, Rock and Roll Over. I believe it's their fifth studio album. It was released on November 11th, 1976. It was produced by Eddie Kramer and was recorded at the Star Theater in New York City. So, just a little bit of real quick backstory before we get into the track by track and Steven's kind of opening opinions on the album. Destroyer came out earlier in 1976, and of course now Destroyer is known to be one of their best, if not their best, studio albums. And I mean, Alive, basically that's where Kiss kind of took off as far as popularity went. And I mean, they got Bob Ezrin to come in to produce Destroyer, which was a very different album comparing it to the first three albums. But still, it's to me a great album. And the album came out in early 76, and while it did sell initially, basically it didn't chart that way. It charted well, but it quickly fell off the chart. So this is essentially, Rock and Roll Over is essentially a Plan B album. So they went back in, and I mean, with the songs on here, you can tell that they kind of took it back to the roots of the first three albums as far as sound went. And they got Eddie Kramer, the guy who produced their huge selling Live album. And as far as backstory goes, that's pretty much it. They recorded it, I believe, from September to October of 1976. And kind of a weird factoid about the album: Peter Criss's drum tracks were recorded in the bathroom of Star Theater in order to get the drum sound they wanted. So that was kind of an interesting ordeal as well. But what is kind of your opening thoughts on the album? I think this is your first time hearing this, am I right?
Right.
All right. So what opening thoughts before we get into the tracks, what's your thoughts on this album?
Well, I've listened to it about 3 or 4 times over, in the past week.
Yeah.
And I think overall it's a really good album, in my opinion. It's got a lot of classic sounding stuff on it. It sounds sort of pop-ish a bit, kind of like you said, the Beatles. And I think it's really a good album, well-written music. A lot of rhythmic changes and such as that. I'll get into that later, but that's my opening thoughts of the album.
All right, and just going about the track listing before we get into the kind of track-by-track review. On my vinyl version, I got the 180-gram vinyl, and the track listing is different on the back than it is on the CD, but that happened at the times of when they were pressing them to vinyl back in the day, because there's several Kiss albums that had the track listing on the back changed, and it was not the track listing on the album at all. But that's just something I noticed on my vinyl version, and I listened to it for the first time. I believe I got it 2 Christmases ago, and I listened to it for the first time this week. I've listened to it on YouTube once. I listened to the first track on CD before I had to leave and go somewhere, so I didn't get to listen to all of it on CD. And I didn't really, you took some notes on this album. I didn't take notes, so I'm kind of going off the cuff here, because I know this album pretty well. I mean, Kiss is one of my favorite bands of all time. Probably actually my favorite band of all time. And this is probably my personal favorite Kiss album by them. And I just think, up next to Live, this is probably my favorite Kiss album. And of course, the Unplugged album being in there somewhere as well. But I guess that's all for backstory and kind of our opening opinion. And let's get into this album with the first track on the album, I Want You. Classic Kiss to me. It was performed kind of on and off during their tours and stuff like that. They performed it during the tour for this album, as well as the one after this for Love Gun. It was dropped until the Creatures of the Night tour in 1982 and 83, and then it was brought back in 1990 for the Hot to Shade tour. And it stayed a pretty significant staple in the set until the reunion tour in 1996. Then it was dropped, and then in 2003 it reappeared, and it's kind of been in the set here off and on since. Of course, now, I mean, Paul Stanley's vocals aren't what they used to be, so they don't perform the song very much anymore, if at all. And but like I said, great track. And it was on a live too after this, a live album that was released in support of the Love Gun album. And great version on there. There's a great version from it's a sound check version that was released on the box set. That's great. There's a version on the what was supposed to be the original live too, Rock and Roll Party in Japan or something like that. There's a great version on there. And after a while, I mean, this song, it played a big part in the crowd participation during the live shows. It got a little bit old after a while, maybe, but still a great track. And now to you, Steve.
All right, brother. I thought the 12-string guitar intro, I think that was a great way to start off an album, first of all. And then we went back to it later in the song. I like the change of rhythm in the bridge parts, what I wrote down. And I just mean by that, most bands don't really know how to do that very well. And Kiss really, with this whole album, in my opinion, does that well. Like kind of has a lot of twists and turns within the music, you know, and doesn't just stick to that one rhythm or drum part, you know. And there's a lot of hooks in all this music. That's what I would like to say about that one, brother. And great track as well. Yeah, I like it a lot.
All right. And also the guitar solo on this track, I meant to touch on it when I was giving my opinions and thoughts on the track. But the first part of the guitar solo is actually played by Paul Stanley. And then the second half of it kind of seeds into Ace Frehley, and he plays the second part of it. So that's kind of an interesting thing, too. So, and they've done that a lot live as well, with them kind of splitting the solo up. But when, like, Vinnie Vincent and Bruce Kulick did it, they took the solo and done something different with it. But that's I Want You, and now we move to the second track on the album. Probably my favorite track on the album, personally. And that is Take Me, another classic Kiss track, sorely missed on a live 2, in my opinion. I mean, I think a live 2 is a perfect album as it is, but I mean, they had problems with, the reason they basically put the studio songs on the fourth side of that album is because they didn't have enough material to fill all four sides. I think you could have put this song on a couple of others, and you could have filled the track listing up on that album. But this track, Take Me, is a great track. There's a live version. It's supposed to be from the vaults, but it's you can tell it's re-recorded in 1996, or at least remixed in 1996, because it features the sound of Paul Stanley's vocals is from that era. And it's on a live compilation called You Wanted the Best, You Got the Best. And I reviewed Dressed to Kill on my YouTube channel, and there's a couple of tracks from that album that there's live versions on there, and it's the same thing. But this was performed on the tour after that supported this album, as well as the tour after it. And then for the Alive 2 tour in 77 and 78, they kind of dropped the track. And it was actually picked up in the early 90s. They performed it for like a one-off deal, I believe, if I'm not bad wrong. And then they performed it a couple of times here and there on the reunion tour in 1996. And there's some good versions of that out there as well. But Take Me, a great track, probably my favorite track on the album. Great solo on the track by Ace Frehley, and that's pretty much all I got on this track. Steven, what do you think of this track?
That's what I've got wrote down too, brother. I said good solo. It's a short solo, but it's a good one though. Fits the track well, in my opinion. And also, I've got, I thought this was written with lots of, well written with lots of rhythm changes as well. Like I said, with pretty much all these songs, that's what I think about them. Not a lot of bands know how to do that well, but obviously Kiss does. So I think there's a lot of good drumming in this one too, brother.
Oh, yeah.
I guess that's about it for me on that one.
All right, and I think that's pretty much it for me too. Like you said, Peter Criss, I mean, this was from the early days up through 77. He was a great drummer, very underrated drummer to me. A lot of people look at him the way he was during the reunion tour and stuff like that, or the Dynasty tour, because he kind of peaked again on the reunion tour. And he built himself back up a pretty good bit. But like on the Dynasty tour, he had kind of had problems with drugs, and that kind of affected the way he performed on drums and stuff like that. And I mean, I think a lot of people look back on that era of the band with him not being the most proficient drummer. But he's one of my personal favorite drummers, one of my bigger influences as a drummer. And that's pretty much all I've got for that track. Then we move to the next track, Calling Dr. Love. Another classic Kiss track, one of their greatest hits, one of the two singles released off the album. And I believe this was the first single. I believe, don't quote me on this, but I mean, a great track all around. Maybe I'm a bit burnt out on it, but still, great track. There's been several remix versions of it on the. There was a remix version on the album Double Platinum from 1978, and there was also a remix version on the track on the album Smashes, Thrashes, and Hits. But this actually wasn't performed on the Rock and Roll Over tour. It was actually picked up for the tour after this for the Love Gun album. So, and it's been a staple pretty much ever since. It was dropped in the 80s and was picked up in the late 80s, and it's been a staple since. They performed it up through this End of the Road tour and stuff like that. But a great version on Alive too. And that's pretty much all I got to say about this track. You take it now, Steve.
All right. I thought there was particularly very good drumming on this one as well. I think he played it perfectly for the song. And musically, very well written, in my opinion. Lots of rhythm changes, and I know I say that a lot, but it's just that's pretty much all of them, what I got from them. I think the drum parts pretty much fit very well with the style of the song. Do you agree, brother?
Oh yeah, it's got to me a great groove, very much so.
Yeah, I just mean like for the groove, he pretty much did 100% what he was supposed to do, I guess what I'm saying, you know.
Yeah.
I guess that's about all, brother.
All right. Well, then we move to the next track, Ladies Room. This track is kind of an underrated Kiss classic. It actually reappeared later, way after the fact, in the Detroit Rock City movie, which, and that was a cool, thing to hear in that film. And it was featured on Alive 2 after this. I'm kind of talking a lot about Alive 2 and stuff like that, but it was featured on the tour to support this album, as well as the Love Gun and Alive 2 tour. But after that, it was dropped, and really, it hasn't been performed since. And a great track, one of the kind of underrated, one of the more underrated tracks on the album, I think. Like I said, classic Kiss. And that's pretty much all I got to say. Great version on a live too. And now to you, Steve.
Well, all the way through this song, I think it was pretty much sort of a straightforward approach to it. I can't really remember if there was a guitar solo or not in there. It just seemed to me that they just got through the main part of the song and just kind of ended it up there. There wasn't much, you know, added on to it from there. And also, at the end, there was a drum part that didn't particularly sound quite right to me or something. It was just, you know, at the very end, how they usually stay on the open hi-hat and a loud sound, you know?
Yeah.
At the end, he went back to the close and did a different cymbal hits and different things, and it just didn't quite fit to me. But other than that, I think it was a great track. I guess that's all for me, brother.
All right. Yeah. Once again, to me, one of the more underrated tracks in the album, but a great track. And I think I've covered all bases with what I wanted to say. But then we get into the next track on the album, Baby Driver. This is the first appearance by Peter Criss on lead vocals. This is a reworked from another track from that came from somewhere else, and it was reworked for this album. And originally, from what I heard, Peter Criss wanted Gene Simmons to sing this track, and there's a demo out there of him singing the track, and it's okay. For what it is, I actually liked it, but this is kind of a grower for me. Initially, when I first heard this album years ago, on the podcast group, where it was formerly the Rock and Metal Combat podcast group, but I did a big run where I reviewed each Kiss album day by day, and I heard a lot of albums I never heard for the first time, and this was at a time that was at a time where I was kind of actually discovering a lot of these albums and actually forming my own opinion about it. But initially, I don't believe I liked this track, but it is a grower. Now I really enjoy it. I think it's one of the better tracks on the album. And Peter Criss kills vocally, probably the best vocalist in Kiss, maybe. Not best, but probably my favorite. That raspy voice is great. And he comes from a different background than a lot of the other members in Kiss. He comes from more of a jazzier background, with people like King Krupa and stuff like that, as far as drumming goes. And a lot of the music as well, is he loved a lot of jazzier stuff and some R&B and stuff like that. But Baby Driver, great track, hard rocking track. That's pretty much all I have to say about that. I don't think this track was ever actually performed live. It may have been rehearsed or something, but I don't believe it was. But you take it now, Steve.
All right, I thought this song was rhythmically very unique. I never heard, them do a guitar part quite like that, a rhythm guitar part, but anybody really. And also, the kind of the lead riff on the chorus part, That's very unique in my mind as well. I've never heard anything like that before much. Great track in my opinion, as well as all these tracks. It had kind of a feel to it, like a more classic feel. That's kind of the way I view this album, really. For all these songs are probably some of their biggest stuff. I don't really know that for sure, but that's just my guess. I guess that's all I've got for that one.
All right. And yeah, this invokes kind of a more classic rock and roll feel, something more akin to like Chuck Berry or something like that. It does give me that vibe, but that's all I really have to say about this track, and you said that's all you have to say, so let's get into the next track, and I believe this opens side two, and that is Love 'Em and Leave 'Em. There's a video out there on YouTube. It was recorded for the Don Kirshner's rock concert. And back in the day, they used to do that a lot. There was a couple of tracks. I believe it was I Want You and Love 'Em and Leave 'Em from this album. And then later down the road, they recorded a video for I Was Made for Loving You and Sure Know Something from the Dynasty albums, which is another album I really want to review sometime or another. But I love this track. I believe this was actually performed live here recently. I believe it was performed more. It was performed live here recently. I want to say it was performed early on during the tour for this album, but I could be wrong. But I think I remember seeing, at least on YouTube, a live version of this from one of the more recent tours. And great track, one of my favorites on the album. And now you take it, Steve.
All right. I'd just like to say I like the pick bass intro and pretty much all the bass playing in this one. I think for me that was the standout instrumentation for me. I like all these tracks, so obviously I think it's a good track. All these very well written. Who was this written by, brother? Do you know?
I believe Gene Simmons. I have the CD here, and I can go check real quickly. But yeah, Gene Simmons is a great bass player, very underrated. Yeah, this was written solely by Gene Simmons.
Okay, well. I think it's very well written there, brother. I guess that's all I got for that one, too.
All right. And yeah, like I was saying, Gene Simmons, incredibly underrated bass player. One of my personal favorite bass players out there. But, yeah, that's pretty much it for that track. And now we move to the next track, Mr. Speed. Classic Kiss track once again. I love this track. I always have and always will. I can't describe in words how much I really enjoy this track. Just overall a very good track. There's a demo version on the box set, and it's pretty cool. I mean, I don't think it's that much different from the studio version, but I think it's a really cool track, and it was featured on the soundtrack to a movie called Speed. I've never watched the film, so I don't really know, but I saw where it was featured on a soundtrack for that film, and I don't believe this track's ever been performed. It may have been performed here more recently, but still a great track. And now you take this one, Steve.
All right, I'd like to get the guitar solo in it, like all the songs. If there is a guitar solo in it, it's not that long, but I think it pretty much, you know, fits the music good. And also in this song, it has a lyric that says "on your knees" or something like that, and it's the second time they said that on the album, I've noticed too. So. It seems like that's kind of a writing staple for them.
Yeah, this album's full of innuendo, so yeah.
And I like the track as well as the oldies, so I guess that's about it for me, brother.
Alrighty, and then we move to the next track, See You in Your Dreams. Another track that's kind of one of the more underrated tracks on the album. It's not talked about a whole lot. It's very much an album track, but I enjoyed it. It was later re-recorded for Gene Simmons' solo album in 1978. I don't know if you know it, but there was a group of solo albums that was released, four by each member. Well, it was one by all four members, and I'm getting my words mixed up here, but each member released a solo album in the year 1978, and it was released with the Kiss name on it, so it's a proper part of the Kiss discography. But yeah, he re-recorded this track as he felt that the version on this album didn't present what he wanted it to present, or somewhere in that neighborhood of things. But I like that version as well. I believe I believe Rick Nielsen of Cheap Trick performs the guitar solo on that version of the track. But yeah, this definitely, it's an album track, and I love it. Always have. And now you take it, Steve.
All right. Particularly, this song reminds me of the Beatles. I guess kind of the voice harmony and all that's kind of why. I thought there was a great solo in it. Guitar solo. Again, short but perfect for the song. And I thought there was some great drum work. Definitely lots of improvisation with that. Just like the whole album, really. With the drums. So, that's all for me, brother.
Alright. Then we'll move to the next track, Hard Luck Woman. This was the second out of the two singles released off the album. I could have got the order mixed up, but I believe this was the second and final single. And touching back on Destroyer real quick, the track, and I know you know this track, Beth.
Mm-hmm.
That track is really what made Destroyer take off. And I mean, Destroyer, like I said, it kind of took a little while to take off. And of course, like I said, now it's known as one of their best, if not their best album. And Beth is, they basically, with Beth, they took the track, it was a B-side to the track Detroit Rock City. And that was one of the bigger singles off of the Destroyer album. Of course, it's a staple to this day. And Paul Stanley stated in the documentary, which I'll talk about in a little while, because I want to do something, talk about what we watched this week or whatever. But Paul Stanley stated in the Extreme Close-Up documentary that they thought the song was a throwaway song, Beth was. And this guy basically flipped the track around and played it on the radio, and it became this huge single. And it's in the liner notes here. I mean, Beth peaked at number 11 on the charts, and it basically shot Kiss up as a musical act, and very much cemented Destroyer as the album it is. But getting back to Hard Luck Woman, I kind of went out on a tangent there, but I just wanted to touch base back backstory. But Hard Luck Woman, this was written for Rod Stewart. And this was written solely by Paul Stanley for Rod Stewart, but eventually, I think it was Gene Simmons suggested Peter Criss to sing it, as he had kind of a similar kind of vibe to Rod Stewart. And this is probably, to me, the best ballad Kiss has ever done. I love this track. I mean, the acoustic guitars just sell it for me. There's a version on a 1994 tribute album that it was a tribute album released by the band. And there's a version of this song with Garth Brooks singing, which is a really good track, and it's probably the most well-known track on that album. And then there's also there's a live version that's electrically played on Alive 2. And then there's also an unplugged version that wasn't released on any of on the album or the original DVD, and it's sung by Paul Stanley, and it's a great version of the track as well. But yeah, Hard Luck Woman, great track, one of my personal favorites on the album, and that's all I really have to say right there. So now you take it, Steven.
Now when you said, I was really surprised, because when you said that it was written for Rod Stewart, I didn't have any idea of that. And I've got wrote down here, it sounds like something Rod Stewart might do. So that's pretty cool. And then I got down here, very unique that the drums are played out so much with the acoustic setting. You know, it's usually kind of, the drums, if anything, are kept percussion or kept pretty low key if it's an acoustic song, but they were played out pretty a lot in this one. And like you said, I like the song, and I thought it sounded like something Rod Stewart would do, especially with a gravelly voice and stuff, like you said. And I thought that was pretty cool there, brother. I guess that's about all for that one.
There's a remixed version on double platinum, the compilation that I've talked about previously with another track. And it's slightly altered. The drums come in at a different time, and that's all I really remember of the track. I haven't heard double platinum in a good long while, but this was written for Rod Stewart, and basically, I think it was Gene Simmons basically told Paul Stanley, hey, this would fit Peter Criss's vocals. And so that's kind of what happened to the song. And it became one of Peter's more well-known songs. And it would be interesting to hear Rod Stewart cover this track at one point. And I'm kind of surprised he never did. But Harlot Woman, great track. Probably to me their best ballad once again. And then we get into the final track on the album, Making Love. This track, a Kiss classic. It was featured as a live version on Live 2. By far to me the best Ace Frehley guitar solo on the album, one of his best ever throughout the Kiss discography that he was involved in, of course. And it was performed for the tour and supported this album. It was performed on the next tour for the Love Gun album, the Alive 2 tour. It was dropped for a while, and then they brought it back in the early 90s and performed it for a while. Then they dropped it for the reunion tour and brought it back shortly for the Psycho Circus tour. And there's a great version of that track out there from that tour, but they dropped it from the set along with a couple of others that was performed. And to me, this track it went over really well in the 1998 on the 1998 tour, and then they performed it sporadically throughout tours here and there, up until, like I said, Paul Stanley's voice kind of lost his voice, and his voice is nowhere near what it used to be. So a lot of these tracks he doesn't perform anymore, because it asked a lot out of his vocal performance. But great track. I think I've covered all the bases, at least from my opinion on this track. And now you take it, Steve.
Well, the other thing that I got from this song is it seems like it could have been off of a throwaway, as you said earlier, from the album, but with the driving rhythm in it, really, and the good drum playing, it makes it pretty listenable. But I don't know why, it just seems like to me that otherwise than that, it just probably would have been left off the album. That's all I like to say for that one.
This was featured on the double platinum compilation. And you've been talking about Peter Criss's drumming. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm trying to think of the word for Peter Criss to describe his drumming. He just had a interesting way of playing. I mean, like I said, he was a very jazzy drummer. But that brings an end to this album. There's some demos out there. Like I said, there's a demo version of Baby Driver with Gene Simmons singing, which is interesting. And I think there's a couple of more demos along with that they kind of surfaced more recently, and it's pretty cool. There's also another song, and this is kind of lost, kind of in the it's kind of a myth in the whole Kiss history, I guess you could say. And there was supposed to be a track on this album, supposedly, called Queen for a Day, and it was supposed to feature the first instance of Ace Frehley on lead vocals. Of course, he would actually wind up performing vocals on the album after this on Love Gun, playing the track Shock Me, which I'll talk about here when I want to get into the tour real quick before we wrap things up. But there was supposedly a song with him on lead vocals called Queen for a Day that's never surfaced. No one's ever heard it, but it's kind of lost in kind of the mythology of history, I guess is how you could describe it. But yeah, that's pretty much it. I don't think there's any other demos, at least that I know of, out there. I'm sure there is, and I'm sure I'm leaving some of them out. But what's your final thoughts on this album, Steve?
My final thoughts, I think it was very well written and rawly produced, as we were talking about earlier. Not a whole lot of instrumentation going on, but it was just enough, you know, to make it come across the right way, I guess is what I'm saying. And great drumming, great bass playing, especially, I think is mainly the main stick-out highlight for this album as far as the instrumentation goes. The whole track has great the vocals on it. In my opinion, really, I think it's a pretty good album. I don't think it has many flaws to it.
Alrighty. And that mirrors my own thoughts altogether. What, like I said, probably my personal favorite Kiss album. It's went to a bunch of different albums before. It's went from this album to Dynasty to Creatures of the Night, Destroyer at one point, Love Gun. I mean, it's been all over the place. Eddie Kramer, who produced this album, of course, he was known for producing Jimi Hendrix back when he was recording and releasing albums before he passed away. And Eddie Kramer, I mean, great producer. He actually produced their first demo. He didn't produce the first album, which was kind of a shame. I wish he would have. And very raw producer. He produced, of course, Alive was the first involvement he had with them. Then he produced this album, which this album was kind of a more, like I said, kind of a more back to basics album, because Destroyer was a kind of more diverse album and music as far as music went. But Eddie Kramer, he produced this album, then he produced Love Gun and Alive 2, and that was kind of the last you heard out of him as being involved with Kiss until he co-produced Alive 3 with Kiss. And Alive 3 has its flaws. I've always really enjoyed it. It's more of a nostalgic factor with me. But, I mean, like I said, it has some flaws. Maybe one day we'll review that album. But Eddie Kramer, great producer. And he also, this same year, I believe, he produced Peter Frampton's huge-selling live album, Frampton Comes Alive. And, I mean, Frampton Comes Alive basically made Peter Frampton's career take off. And great. He's one of my personal favorite producers. He's produced all kinds of stuff. He produced Ace Frehley's self-titled solo album in 78. And the tour for this, just get into it real quick. They toured from 76 through 77. Probably the most well-known show from this tour is the Budokan Japan show from 1977. It was pro shot. It was actually recorded for an album. They were going to release, it was going to be a Japan-only live album. It was recorded by Eddie Kramer, and it was called, like I said earlier, Rock and Roll Party in Japan, or Rock and Roll Party in Tokyo, or something like that. And basically, they shelved the album. It's been bootlegged. It's one of the more bootlegged albums out there. Great live show. The full show was released on Kissology Box 1, which was a big DVD set they released of their concerts. And a great show. The Lost Alive 2 albums is what the bootleg's called. And it takes the demos from the studio tracks from Alive 2 and puts them with the live album from Budokan in 77. And I'll probably put that album under our dialogue and stuff when I edit this thing together. But I just want to out of ten, how do you rate this album, Steve?
I'll probably say 9 out of 10. What I'd say.
9 out of 10. I think I may go in that. I may do the same thing. Probably a 9 out of 10 as well. Great album. You got any? Did you watch anything this week? I was talking about I wanted to do that. Have you watched anything this week?
No.
As far as
what?
As far as movies and stuff like that.
No, not any movies. No, not really.
All right. Well, me and you did. We attempted to record some commentaries that didn't completely work out because of phone calls. But
yeah.
But I watched quite a bit here and there. I watched last night. I watched Rob Zombie's Three from Hell, and we were supposed to record this last night on May the 1st, but there was some scheduling differences between me and. Basically, things came up that I didn't expect to come up, and basically, we had to call recording off until this morning. It's May the 2nd, 2020, and I watched Three from Hell, the newest Rob Zombie film, his third in the House of a Thousand Corpses and the Devil's Rejects trilogy, or however you want to say it, but I enjoyed that film for what it was. It could have been better, but it got a tad bit slow in the middle, but I still liked it. And I scored a bunch of movies at Walmart yesterday, so I'm going to have a lot of other stuff to watch. I did watch Kiss Extreme Close-Up, the documentary from 92. I watched it during the week. First time I actually seen it all the way through, I seen an edited version from VH1 back in the day. It was online. And I think that's pretty much all I've watched this week. Trying to think of some other. I watched Wes Craven's Shocker earlier in the week. And I watched the 89 Batman, Tim Burton's Batman. And I think that's pretty much it as far as stuff I've watched. You listen to any album, Steven?
Yeah, I've listened to some stuff that I want to review in the future. Some 38 Special, 2 or 4, I guess is how you pronounce it. I think that's a great album, especially the first half, but all of it's pretty good. And also, REO Speedwagon. I would like to do some of that, an album called You Can't Tune a P piano. You can tune a piano, but you can't tune a fish. That's a very good album, in my opinion. And also, I think we're going to do some stuff where we had an album that I've been editing a lot lately and trying to put together tour songs that we recorded at Devin's house. Devin on drums, me on guitar, and then I've got two or three songs that I wrote that I put on there, and then one we did at my house. So we might do it. I'm thinking about doing a video where we talk about that. What do you think about that, Devin?
That's fine, yeah.
All right, well, that's what I was thinking as far as my choices for albums to review.
Okay. Well, I listened to the Blues Brothers and Friends live from Chicago's House of Blues. A great live album. One of my favorite live albums of all time. I mean, the Blues Brothers. I was introduced to them through this. It was this TV special called On Parole and in Concert. They were playing, I believe, the closing segments of, I can't remember now exactly, but it was from the mid '90s. They had reunited. It was Jim Belushi and Dan Aykroyd and John Goodman together as Brother Z, Elwood, Mighty Mac Blues, and they did a show in Atlanta, Georgia, and. And that's what introduced me to the Blues Brothers. I mean, they had reunited with the Blues Brothers band at this point. There had been a bunch of different incarnations of that by this time. And great album. This was recorded. This was the opening night of the Chicago's House of Blues. I have the CD here, so it's up on YouTube. You can find it there. Great live album. It's a very raw produced live album, and I'm trying to think of some other stuff I listened to. I listened to David Coverdale's second solo album, North Winds, from 1978. This was right before he formed the group Whitesnake, which is some other albums I want to review in the future. And yesterday I listened to Eric Clapton's 1986 album, August, and one of my personal favorite Clapton albums, and it's got some great tracks on there. And I started listening to something else, and now I'm totally blank on it. But of course, we've both listened to Kiss Rock and Roll Over multiple times. So
oh yes,
that's kind of a no brainer there. But you got a couple of tracks you want to play at the end of the video or the review?
Okay. Do you want them to be Kiss?
It can be anything. It can be any time.
Okay. Well, maybe we can place
kind of in a rock genre or so.
We could even play some of our stuff at the end if you want to.
It don't matter. Well, we can play just pick a couple trades. I mean, it doesn't matter from what artist or whatever.
I mean, I guess you could put out stuff at the end, right?
Yeah, possibly, yeah.
Because, I mean, it's a YouTube video, so yeah. Maybe Pretending we did and Crossroads we did.
Okay.
You like that idea?
That's fine. And, trying to think of a couple of tracks. I believe it's called Sweet Mistreater from the Coverdale's solo album North Winds. And I'm gonna go with one of our tracks we recorded called it's our cover of Rambling on My Mind that you've done on guitar. And I was actually playing organ somewhat, so
yeah. That actually went really well. That was kind of off of a whim, wasn't it?
Yeah.
That's the one that was recorded at my house.
Yeah. But that's pretty much been our second episode. I hope you all enjoy. Like I said, like Steven said last week, this is first going to go up on my YouTube channel. Plug to both mine and his YouTube channel. He's been putting up a lot of videos. He's been recalibrating his YouTube channel. I've changed the name of my reviews. I went back old school for mine and changed them to the Danger Zone Reviews. And that's old school from back when I first did reviews, of course, that I've deleted since. But the first episode of that I ever reviewed back then was Black Sabbath's Seventh Star, which was essentially a Tony Iommi solo album. And that's another one I want to review. You good with that one?
Oh, yeah.
But, I mean, check out both of our YouTube pages. This is being recorded on May the 2nd, 2020. And, I mean, I don't know what's going to be next as far as reviews go, but or as far as the podcast goes, as far as topics or whatever, or what album we're going to review. Like I said, there were a couple of commentaries me and Steven had done, but aborted because of interruptions, some phone calls that come through on my end, and we're going to try to do those commentaries again one of these days. And, I mean, this has pretty much been our second episode. I hope the beginning isn't, it doesn't have such a bad audio malfunction. When I was editing together our first podcast, there was a bad audio malfunction at the beginning. But, I edited it just as much as I could. But, it'll be up here pretty soon, sometimes in this coming week. And we were going to record yesterday on May the 1st, but things just kind of fell through. But visit both of our YouTube pages. Eventually I'm going to have a YouTube page of our own for our podcast. And we are planning to do a whole lot of different episodes in the future, and I want to kind of get our repertoire, I guess is what you could say, built up, and put a bunch of stuff out here in the future, and maybe do some top live albums of all time, or stuff like that, or do some movie reviews, or something like that. But that's pretty much all I've got to say as far as this goes. Rock and Roll Over, great album. And, this will be on my YouTube channel. I mean, like, comment, subscribe, and spread the word, like I always say. And, do the same with Stevens. Like, comment, subscribe, and also hit the bell to where you get notifications every time my videos are up. I try to release videos, every Monday, so, I'll have one up this Monday, which whenever you hear this, I mean, it'll be probably after the fact. But this is the Dunnigan Mott Music and Movie Podcast. I'm Devin Dunnigan, and this is Steven Mott. You got anything else to say, Steve?
It was a great album, and also you can check out me and Devin's, some of our music that we've recorded on my channel. Steven Mott, it's called, and that's some really good stuff on there, and you should go check that out. And I guess that's all for me, brother.
All right, well, I think I've covered all the bases as far as this album goes. Classic album. Of course, the first album. By the time you hear this, the first album review that we've done was 1970s. Derek and the Dominoes, Layla and Other Assorted Love Songs. And I just real quick wanted to touch on something that we didn't touch on during the review. Where did the Derek and the Dominoes name come from?
That came because they didn't have a name for a while, and then when they came to their first gig or first big gig, they were talking, and then one of them said Eric and the Dominoes or something
And then somebody else, and then when they announced it, the guy actually came out and said Derek and the Dominoes, and it just stuck. So.
Yeah, that was something I said when I was listening back to it. I said we missed that, and it was originally Eric and the Dynamos, I believe is what it was called, and then the guy, like you said, the guy mispronounced it as Derek and the Dominoes, and it's like you said, it stuck. And we may do a live album from them later on, just to talk about it. But according to the recording right now, it says we've been going for 57 minutes, and
well, we've been on the phone before that for a while. You're talking about the recording itself, huh?
Yeah. But total amount of time we've been on the phone is an hour and 18 minutes. But,
yeah.
But that's been our second episode of the Dunnigan Mott Music and Movie Podcast. We hope you all enjoy, and thank you very much. God bless you all. And see you next time.
When she said she was pretending like she knew the plan, that's when I knew she was pretending to understand, pretending.
Mm-hmm.